Good morning. Welcome to worship here at Woodlawn Lutheran Church today. It's good to be with you in God's house. So we gather together and praise and thank our God for the work of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Special welcome to our guests and visitors. Glad you could be with us today for worship. At some point, we ask all of our worshipers to please sign the friendship register. It's on the center aisle of each pew, the little red books. Please take a moment to greet the people around you and welcome them to worship also. In our scripture readings and sermon today, we're reminded that weak and sinful people like us really don't belong in the presence of holy, almighty God. And yet, God is merciful and God is forgiving, and He says we should repent of our sins, and He welcomes us into His presence so that we can be blessed when He is with us always. And so the idea of repentance and God's welcome of us weak, sinful sinners is kind of the theme today. And that comes in the gospel, which sets the theme from Luke chapter 13, reminding us of God's patience with us, reminding us that life is fragile. We don't know how much time we have. Now is the time. Now is the time to get to know God's love and mercy. At that time, there were some present who told Jesus about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mixed with their sacrifices. He answered them, "Do you think that these Galileans were worse sinners than all the other Galileans because they suffered these things? I tell you, no. But unless you repent, you will all perish too. Or those 18 who were killed when the tower in Siloam fell on them, do you think that they were worse sinners than all the people living in Jerusalem? I tell you, no. But unless you repent, you will all perish too." He told them this parable. A man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard. He came looking for fruit on it, but he did not find any. So he said to the gardener, "Look, for 3 years now, I have come looking for fruit on this fig tree, and I've found none. Cut it down. Why even let it use up the soil?" But the gardener replied to him, "Sir, leave it alone this year also, until I dig around it and put fertilizer on it. If it produces fruit next year, fine. But if not, then cut it down." This is the gospel of our Lord. We sing our opening hymn, "Speak, O Lord."
Thank you.
Please stand. We worship in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. Blessed are they whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Let us confess our sins to the Lord. Almighty and merciful Father, we have strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed what we have devised and desired in our own hearts. We have offended you and sinned against your holy law. We have done those things that we should not have done, and we have not done those things that we should have done. Have mercy on us, Lord. Spare us, forgive us, and restore us according to your promises in Christ Jesus. God, our merciful Father, has forgiven all our sins. He sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Redeemer and Savior. Jesus paid the penalty for our guilt by his death on the cross and freed us from death by his resurrection from the grave. We have peace with God, now and forever. Amen. Let us pray together the prayer of the day. O God, whose glory it is always to have mercy, be gracious to all who have gone astray from your ways, and bring them again with penitent hearts and steadfast faith to embrace and hold fast the unchangeable truth of your word. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. Join together in Psalm 85. We speak it responsively. You showed favor to your land, O Lord. You restored Jacob. You removed the guilt of your people. Restore us, O God, who saves us. Put an end to your indignation with us. Will you be angry with us forever? Will you extend your anger through all generations? Show us your mercy, O Lord, and give us your salvation. I will hear what the true God, the Lord, will say. He indeed speaks peace to his people, to his favored ones. But do not let them turn to foolish ways. Mercy and truth meet together. Righteousness and peace kiss each other. Truth springs up from the earth, and righteousness looks down from heaven. The Lord will indeed give good things, and our land will yield its harvest. Sunday school will now sing, Glory Be to Jesus. Reading for today from the Apostle Paul, his first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 10, verses 1 through 13. Paul urges us to learn from the example of his own people, to learn that when we're faced with trials and troubles in our lives, that we should turn to the Lord. For I do not want you to be unaware, brothers, that our fathers were all under the cloud and all passed through the sea, and they were all baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. They all ate the same spiritual food and all drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank from the spiritual rock that accompanied them, and that rock was Christ. Nevertheless, God was not pleased with most of them. He had them die in the wilderness. Now these things took place as examples to warn us not to desire evil things the way they did. Do not become idolaters like some of them, as it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and got up to celebrate wildly. And let us not commit sexual immorality as some of them did, and in one day 23,000 fell. Let us not put Christ to the test, as some of them did, and so were being destroyed by the serpents. And do not grumble, as some of them grumbled, and were destroyed by the destroyer. All these things that were happening to them had meaning as examples, and they were written down to warn us, to whom the end of the ages has come. So let him who thinks he stands be careful that he does not fall. No testing has overtaken you except ordinary testing, but God is faithful. He will not allow you to be tested beyond your ability, but when he tests you, he will also bring about the outcome that you are able to bear it. This is God's word. We sing together now our next song, Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. Hopefully the Amazing Grace verses are familiar to you, and you'll be able to pick up on the other portion as well.
Like a flood, his mercy reigns unending.
Sermon for today is from Exodus chapter 3, verses 1 through 15. Now Moses was shepherding the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, a priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the far side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. The angel of the Lord appeared to him in a blazing fire from within a bush. Moses saw that the bush was on fire, but the bush was not burning up. So he said, "I will go over and look at this amazing sight to find out why the bush is not burning up." When the Lord saw that Moses had gone over to take a look, God called to him from the middle of the bush and said, "Moses, Moses." Moses said, "I am here." The Lord said, "Do not come any closer. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place where you are standing is holy ground." He then said, "I am the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. The Lord said, "I have certainly seen the misery of my people in Egypt, and I have heard their cry for help because of their slave drivers. Yes, I am aware of their suffering. So I have come down to deliver them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land to a good and spacious land, to a land flowing with milk and honey, to the place of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. Now indeed, the Israelites' cry for help has come to me. Yes, I have seen how the Egyptians are oppressing them. Come now, I will send you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt." But Moses said to God, "Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and that I should bring the Israelites out of Egypt?" So he said, "I will certainly be with you. This will be the sign to you that I have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will serve God on this mountain." But Moses said to God, "If I go to the Israelites and say to them, 'The God of your fathers has sent me to you,' and they ask me, 'What is his name?' what should I say to them?" So God replied to Moses, "I am who I am." He also said, "You will say this to the Israelites, 'I am has sent me to you.'" God also told Moses, "Say this to the Israelites, 'The Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this is how I am to be remembered from generation to generation.'" This is God's word. Somebody comes up to you and says something kind of strange, gives you some information that you've never heard before that catches you off guard. What's a natural reaction? You probably want to ask questions, right? You might not be satisfied with just the basic information. You want to dig deeper and find out more so you can really comprehend and understand what's happening. God came to Moses, and he told him that Moses would lead his people out of slavery. Talk about disrupting your life, huh? Moses had been minding his business for the last 40 years, and his business had been taking care of sheep. There's no indication Moses had any desire to go back to the land that he had fled from 40 years earlier. But returning to his people was exactly what God had in mind for Moses. When Moses heard what God had planned for him, he could have had the attitude of the prophet Isaiah, who lived a number of centuries later. When God called him to serve, he said, "Here am I, send me." He was eager to serve the Lord. But Moses seemed a little more reluctant, and he asked some burning questions, questions that were burning inside his heart and mind that he wanted answers to. God did respond. God responded to the concerns that Moses had. We probably would have asked similar questions if God called us to such incredible works of service in his kingdom. Maybe we ask similar questions even today. And we don't hear the voice of God directly speaking from a burning bush today, but we certainly have the voice of God speaking through His Word, answering our questions, responding to our concerns. Questions today are pretty simple, questions that Moses asked, questions that we probably ask too. Who am I? Who are you, Lord? We want answers. Who am I? Moses. If you lived at the time of Jesus, it was obvious who Moses was. Moses was the great leader of God's people who led them out of slavery. Through Moses, God had given the law to His people. Moses was a man who walked closer to God than anybody we can possibly even imagine, aside from Jesus Christ Himself. But Moses also knew who he was. He knew his life. He knew his history. He had been saved from death by the daughter of the Egyptian ruler. He had been raised in the palace of Pharaoh, leader of Egypt. And he had killed an Egyptian for beating up on a Hebrew slave. And he ran away. He ran away at the age of 40 after he discovered that people knew about his murder. That's who Moses was. So why does he ask the question then? Who am I? Was he being modest? Was he afraid? Did he really not understand what the Lord was trying to tell him here? He knew he wasn't worthy to have this great responsibility placed on his shoulders. He wasn't really capable of doing the things that God asked him. Moses had a sinful nature who was very reluctant to respond to the Lord's call. He would rather have said, "Thanks, Lord, but no thank you." But God would have none of his excuses. No, Moses was not worthy. No, Moses did not have the power. But look at God's response. A simple answer, but full of comfort and full of power. "I will certainly be with you. This will be the sign to you that I have sent you. When you've brought the people out of Egypt, you will serve God on this mountain." Two promises from God to show Moses it didn't really matter who Moses was. It only mattered who God is. Certainly probably a pretty scary opportunity for Moses. Kind of like going into a hungry lion's den. He would face ridicule and rejection and threats on his life. But God reassured him. He wasn't going to be alone. God promised to be with him every step of the way. And he promised that when it was all said and done, they would come back to this mountain and they would praise and thank God for freeing them from slavery. Who am I? Who are you? Good questions for us too, aren't they? Maybe we ask these questions out of modesty or feelings of insecurity. Or maybe we ask these questions in an effort to get out of some responsibility someone wants us to carry out. Who are we that we should have the opportunity to serve God in our lives? Who are we that we should have the freedom to gather here to worship our God? Who are we that we should have the privilege of sharing the good news to the world that we have a Savior? Like Moses, our lives are deeply scarred by sin. Maybe we haven't committed murder, but maybe we're filled with bitterness, resentment, and anger sometimes, or filled with fear and cowardice and failed to stand up for what's right. Maybe we're not willing to do the things that God wants us to do. In a very real way, that's who we are, sinful, weak people, scarred and bruised because of our foolishness. But in the light of God's mercy, we are also forgiven people, redeemed, rescued, people chosen by God's grace. God says to us too, "I will be with you." Why would He make such a promise? How can God stand to be with people that say and do so much that He hates? Only through our Savior Jesus, who reminds us the healthy do not need a physician, but the sick do. "I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." Earthly speaking, Moses probably had some pretty good qualifications, some pretty good experience that God could use to make him a good leader. But God didn't pick Moses because he was the most qualified. Moses was a sick sinner who needed to be healed. He was an unworthy servant, and he knew it, and God knew it. But that brought even greater glory to God, who was able to make a powerful servant out of an unworthy candidate. By God's grace and mercy and power, Moses would be the one who rose to a position of servant leadership at a very important time in the history of our world. By God's grace, Moses became a true shepherd, a shepherd of God's people, caring for their spiritual well-being. By God's grace and mercy and power, we are called to be servants of God too, unworthy, but washed pure in the blood of Jesus Christ, our Savior. We're here now, and only God knows how our service will have everlasting effects in His kingdom. Only God knows how He will use us to bless and to encourage others through Jesus our Savior. Moses had more questions, didn't he? Since God had given him an answer to his first question, he asked another one. If I go to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they ask me, what's his name? What should I tell them? God's people had been living in the land of Egypt. The Egyptians worshipped many different gods. Had the Hebrews lost their faith in the Lord? Some of them do appear to have been influenced by the religious beliefs of the Egyptians, but undoubtedly, the promises that God had given to Abraham and Isaac and Jacob had been passed down from generation to generation. God wanted Moses to remind the people of the promises he had made. I am who I am. He also said, you will say this to the Israelites, I am has sent me to you. God also told Moses, say this to the Israelites, the Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this is how I am to be remembered from generation to generation. It's definitely a name like no other name, similar to the special name of God that we sometimes pronounce Yahweh. It was the name that Jesus identified himself with when he proclaimed to the people of first century Jerusalem, Amen, amen, I tell you, before Abraham was born, I am the God who is. He does not change. He is ever present. He was with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and Moses. He walked to this earth in the first century, and he is with us today, just as he promises. The special name that God used for himself in the Old Testament emphasizes God's promises, that when God makes a promise, he's going to keep that promise. God had promised that his people would return from Egypt and settle in the promised land. They should have known that very clearly, but how it would all happen, how they would be set free, how they would go to that promised land, they didn't really understand. That was a big question. It was a question until Moses arrived in Egypt with a message from the great I Am. Obviously, if Moses was going to carry out this great task, he would need a letter of reference. Who was it that was sending him? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, our God, our Savior, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Moses would not be doing this on his own. He would be carrying out the Lord's will. People would need to look past Moses and all his weaknesses and frailties so that they could see him who is, the one who keeps his promise of mercy, the one who brings us to repentance, changes hearts and lives, and gives strength and courage and even joy, no matter what circumstances we're faced with in life. It's an interesting section of Scripture, the miracle of the bush that didn't burn up, the holy ground on Mount Horeb, God's compassion and mercy for his people who were oppressed. These are all important events in the history of God's people. These are important events in our history too. We are children of Abraham because the Holy Spirit has given us repentance and the same faith that Abraham had to believe in the ever-present God of mercy and grace. the one who takes unworthy people like us, washes us clean, and equips us to serve him. Whatever purpose God has in your life might not always be clear to you, but believe that your life has a very important purpose. We are unworthy, but God has connected us to Christ, and he will use us. When the time comes, when the opportunities arise, don't be afraid. Don't look to yourself and focus on your weaknesses and on your sins. Instead, fix your heart firmly on your loving Savior, who is the great I Am. Amen. Please stand. Now the peace of God, which goes beyond our understanding, will guard and keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. We join together in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. We'll now watch the Wells Connection for the month of March.
Hi, I'm Wells President Mark Schrader. It's no secret that Christian churches in Europe have been in decline for many decades, drifting further and further from the truth of Scripture. As distressing as that is, it does provide an opportunity for a church that offers solid biblical teaching.
These people are gathering to worship our Lord at the Wells Mission Church in London. What this group lacks in size, it makes up for in commitment. Members realize that the truths Wells teaches are missing in most other churches here.
I think the religious institutions that are kind of native to this country have lost their way in a lot of senses, and people are crying out for something more substantial.
It was the most wonderful, deep, fabulous teaching that we've been longing for all our life, really, so it's been brilliant, real life-changing experience.
Because this group doesn't have a full-time pastor, they only meet once a month when the Wells chaplain from Germany visits. But that hasn't diminished their enthusiasm.
As the Apostle Paul said in 1 Corinthians, they're eager to be able to share their faith on a regular basis with each other, but also to reach out with their Christian faith to others.
London may soon be getting a significant influx of Lutherans. The reason? China. As China cracks down on religious freedom in Hong Kong, many Christians are fleeing.
And there's great concern about whether Christianity is going to be able to continue in Hong Kong as it has. And so we have found out that our sister church body in Hong Kong has had about 20% of their members move over to England. As chapter 8 begins, says that that was actually the beginning of a fierce persecution in Jerusalem.
So our synod has responded to these events by making plans to call a full-time missionary to London to better meet the need and to take advantage of new opportunities.
I've been praying for it very earnestly, and I can't tell you how overjoyed I am. I just can't. Cumbria is just wonderful. Yeah.
And in London particularly, I think there's a real need for a Christ-centered, scripture-based Christian outreach and community.
London is a truly international city, with immigrants from around the world arriving daily. People in transition are often open to hearing the good news of Jesus, and our mission is poised for this new opportunity.
God willing, after the first missionary is established, a second will be added, perhaps focused specifically on serving people arriving from Hong Kong. While a door in Hong Kong may be closing, God is opening a new door in London.
We have a number of special prayers today, a number of people in our congregation with various health concerns, Bev Bach at St. Luke's Hospital, Jim Wishman and Bob Carnico recovering from surgery, John Garisher in having rehab at Maplewood Village at Manor Park, so we include all of them in our prayers. We also pray for Lynette Bliefernicht, whose father just passed away. Funeral will be held down in Crete, Illinois on Tuesday morning. And also we pray for our principal of our Lamb of God School, Mr. Tim McCain, who has received a call to serve at St. Paul's Lutheran in Bangor, Wisconsin. Compassionate Father, in your mercy, you transform even sickness and disease into a blessing for your children. With this confidence, we commit all who are sick or suffering to your tender care. We pray today for Bev and John and Bob and Jim. Provide healing and relief according to your infinite wisdom and boundless mercy. Grant to them patient endurance if their suffering must linger, and help them to find true spiritual strength through Jesus and his cross during their time of physical weakness. By the work of the Holy Spirit, teach them to trust in your forgiveness, your grace, and your love. We thank you for the mercies with which you blessed Lynette Bliefernicht's father, who has now fallen asleep. We thank you especially for having brought him to know your Son, Jesus Christ, as his Savior. We pray now that you would comfort his family and all who mourn his death with your precious promises, and that you would cheer them with the sure hope of a blessed reunion in heaven. Grant his body rest, and at last, together with us all, a joyful resurrection to life everlasting. Teach us all to number our days, that we may gain hearts of wisdom, and finally be saved through Jesus Christ, our risen and ever-living Lord. And Lord Jesus, you instituted the office of the public ministry. You have given your people the privilege of extending calls to serve us through that ministry. Having asked for your help and guidance, St. Paul's in Bangor, Wisconsin has called Mr. McCain to serve as their principal. We ask that as he prayerfully considers this call, you would guide him to a decision that is in the best interest of your kingdom. As we await his decision, bless our congregation and school and its ministry, that your kingdom may continue to grow and flourish among us. We ask this in your name, because you are the good shepherd, and you are the head of the church. And in your name we also pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Continue now with our final song for today. It's called His Mercy Is More. We'd like the congregation to join us on the refrain, so we're going to practice it together first. If you got the printed copies, it's all the way on the back page. Hopefully the tune is pretty catchy. So we'll sing through the refrain one time.
Praise the Lord. His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more.
So that's how the refrain goes. So we will start out now with the refrain, and then the worship team will sing the verses. So please join us every time we sing the refrain.
Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. What love could remember, no wrongs we have done. Omniscient, all-knowing, He counts not their sum. Drawn into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. What patience would wait as we constantly roam? What Father so tender is calling us home? He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. His sins, they are many, His mercy is more. What riches of kindness He lavished on us. His blood was the payment, His life was the cost. We stood neath a debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more.
Now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you His peace. Amen. Great to worship with you today and rejoice in the blessings of our Savior, who calls us to repentance and promises that our sins have all been paid for. Next weekend, after all of our worship services, we're going to be taking a door collection for the food pantries that we support, so we encourage you to plan ahead and give generously. Our midweek Lenten services continue on Wednesday at 3:30 and 6:30. Pastor Oftenberg from Jordan will be our guest preacher this week. A reminder to sign up for a couple of things coming up. Our teens are having an event on Palm Sunday, April 10th. I always say that wrong. It's a Sky Zone out in Waukesha. We're working together with Good Shepherds in Jordan and St. John's in Wauwatosa. We're trying to get a big group so we can get a group discount. So we're asking people to RSVP by March 26th. There's a link in the weekly newsletter that you can follow to sign up ahead of time. We also have an Easter for All event, kind of an all-ages Easter for kids. That's on Saturday morning, April 9th, from 9:30 to 11:30 with luncheon to follow. There's also a sign-up for that online as well. And we've got some flyers on the table just to the left as you leave the sanctuary. You can take them for your own reminder, but especially to invite someone to join you for that event. And just a reminder, we have a voters meeting next Sunday after the late service to issue calls for first and second and third and fourth for our Lamb of God school. There's refreshments in room 206 after the service. We encourage you to stick around and visit with one another. God's blessings to all of you.